Donald MacLeod on Glengarry's Lament. I am reading from the Kilberry Collection, in which this tune is number 100. Before proceeding with the tune itself, we should look at the basic Crunlough and the basic Turlough. Let us take the Turlough first. The basic Turlough consists of three grace notes. One, close the chanter, or if you prefer, sound low G. Two, still on low G, play a D grace note. And three, raise the little finger to low A with the E grace note flush upon it. Slowly it is. It is then only a simple matter to play that basic movement after any themal note in the text. When the themal note happens to be D, which doesn't occur in this tune, then the B grace note will be played instead of the D grace note on low G. The basic Crunlough consists of five grace notes, not to be confused with a basic Turlough plus. The basic Crunlough, close the chanter, or sound low G, still on low G, play a D grace note, raise the little finger to low A with the E grace note flush upon it, still on low A, play an F grace note, finally raising the E finger to E. Five separate little movements. One, two, three, four, five. And slowly it is. And regardless of how quickly you can play the movement, you should hear the five basic little pulses. As in the Turlough, when the themal note is D, then the B grace note should be played on low G instead of the D grace note. Now that is phase one, and both the basic Turlough and Crunlough should be mastered before proceeding with the ground. In the ground we find three cadential movements. At the beginning of bar one we have a cadential E introducing the parent note low A. It is simply a high G grace note on E introducing low A. And it sounds something like this. If we move along to bar four and the second last note, C, it is introduced by a different type of cadential movement. We have the high G grace note on E, followed by the D grace note on C. And that D grace note is generally what we might call a bigger grace note than we would play in light music. And it sounds. If we move along to the end of the line, the second last note in the line, B, it is introduced by an exactly similar cadential movement, only this time the D grace note is on the parent note B, and it sounds. And these are the three different types of cadential movement that we meet in the ground. There is a golden rule for cadential E's, and that is that although they may vary in length, they are never short. I treat them as an and word, as I would in poetry. Now here, in one line of text, we have three lines of the ground. Line one, you'll notice the first phrase, it's a two-barred phrase, as they all are. The first phrase is repeated. So line one will be phrases one, 1, 3. Line 2, we play the whole of the text, but no repeat of phrase 1. We play phrase 1, 2, 3. And line 3, we simply play phrase 1, not repeated, and phrase 3. Listen carefully to the and notes, the joining notes, which vary in length as I sing line 1. Remember, phrases 1, 1, 3. And 1, and 2, 3, and 1, and 2, 3, and 1, and 2, 3, and 1, and 2, 3. Over to phase 3, we begin it with the grip straight from the last low A in phrase 1. 1 and 2 3 and 1 and 2 3. Now line 2, phrases 1, 2 and 3. And an aid to memorizing, the only difference between phrases 2 and 3 occur in the penultimate note. In phrase 2, the second last note is C, and in phrase 3, it is B. And 1 and 2 3, and 1 and 2 3, 1 and 2 3, and 1 and 2 3. 1 and 2 3, and 1 and 2 3. And line 3, phrases 1 and 3. And 1 and 2 3, and 1 and 2 3. 1 and 2 3, and 1 and 2 3. Now here is the ground on the practice chanter. Master that before proceeding any further. The construction in each of the succeeding variations is exactly the same as that of the ground. Let me repeat it. Line 1, phrases 1, 1, 3. Line 2, phrases 1, 2, 3. and line 3, phrases 1 and 3. Variation 1. Here we have the notes written in couplets. Your first note in each couplet is long and the second short. And basically, the first note will have a high G grace note and the second an E grace note. Where that is physically impossible, as in the first couplet of bar 2, then both notes will have a high G grace note. All the weight on the first note, not too much heard of the second, and we go for balance. We get balance by, as nearly as humanly possible, having all our long notes the same length and our short notes of similar duration. There is no point in playing line 1 like this. Entirely lacking in character, because A, I did not dwell long enough on the first note, and B, we heard too much of the short note. We should aim for something like this. Next we have the doubling of variation 1. All doublings are played only very slightly faster in tempo than singlings. And to play the doubling, we look at variation 1, and instead of coming to low A each time for our second note, we repeat the first or themal notes. Phrase 1 then would be 2 low A's, 2 C's, 2 E's, 2 C's. And to complete line 1, phrase 3 would be 2 B's, 2 F's, 2 E's and 2 B's. And remember that it is played that little bit faster than the singling. But we slow down towards the end of line 3, in order that we approach our next singling at a reasonable singling speed. So here is a doubling of variation 1. Ever so slightly towards the end of line 3. And this is where our basic tourlaut comes in handy, because we are going to play it from each themal note in the text, and remember that the themal note will have a high G grace note. Line 1 of the singling will be tourlaut to low A, from low A, from C, from E, then we have the cadential movement. Disregard entirely that little bracket with the C. That phrase, of course, is repeated, and we go along to phrase 3. Tourlaut to low A, from B, F, E, then the cadential movement to B. Disregarding again that little bracket containing the C. You will notice when playing line 2 that there is no cadential movement in phrase 2. Again, we go for balance, as we did in variation 1, all the weight on the first note of each tonal movement, not too much heard of the end of the movement. And the tonal singling would be to the last stave on the page and play the tourlo doubling. The tourlo movement from each of the themal notes that we find on that stave. And of course, a high G grace note on each of the themal notes. Remember that the doubling is played that little bit faster than the singling, but that we slow down towards the end of line 3. So the tonal doubling might be back to the previous stave for the crumlower singling. When we played the tourlower singling, I asked you to ignore that little bracket containing C. I would ask you again to ignore it, simply because the writer here indicates that he likes the last E of the crumlower movement before the cadence lengthened. I do not lengthen the last E of the crumlower movement before the cadence. Let me read out line 1 to you. A crumlower from low A, C, from E, then the cadential movement. That is repeated. Over to phrase 3, a crumlower from B, F, E, then the cadential movement. I'll play one line at a time here. So line 1 would be, and may I stress that all the weight is on the first note of each crumlower movement. Thank you. Line 2, phrases 1, 2 and 3. And line 3, phrases 1 and 3. We then go to the last stave for the Krungla doubling. It is played, as I've already said, slightly faster than the singling. This time, because it is the ultimate variation, we do not slow down towards the end of line 3. And I like to end with line 3 of the Ground. That was Glengarry's Lament.